Hey, it's Fran. In the lab, with a lot on my mind, I'm not the first to talk about this. Other channels have been talking about it, you know, the release of ChatGPT and the consequences thereof for cheating on student papers and writing essays and things like that. And, you know, chatbots are very good at coalescing data, and this new chatbot, ChatGPT, is uncommonly good among its peers in being able to create, like, readable text in real time. But the larger overarching scope of all of these AI media generators has been playing out in lots of articles, and I've been reading so many opinions, not only from artists, but also technologists and computer scientists and people really trying to figure out where this is going in the very near future. A really big article written by Sarah Anderson, an illustrator and cartoonist, was in the Times. The Dark Possibilities of AI and Art. And it's a very long article, but in it she talks about her history over the years with imitators using various kinds of AI to generate copies of her very signature style comics. And she said at some point someone had generated a font that was based on her own handwriting so that people could make little memes and copy her style in ways that, unless you were really discerning, even she admitted you really wouldn't be able to tell that she didn't make the comic. And it really boils down to this idea that where does the artist fit in the upcoming years when these AI media generators for visuals and also for text are getting so good at just rendering something so captivating, you know, winning contests, winning attention. And there's so many examples throughout the internet of people generating imagery and text with all these bots. So I don't really have to put too fine a point on exactly how good these bots are getting. But it really made me think about the job of the artist, including like this really great tome that I have on photorealism. A couple photorealists, very famous photorealists, have died over the past year or so. It made me realize that for an artist that would spend, you know, upwards of a year to make a painting like this, you know, a painting, spend thousands of hours to create a painting like this. These aren't photographs, these are paintings. And Don Eddy's famous paintings of automobiles. again, I'm trying to get no reflection, but yeah. So, but photorealism is one thing that I've been obsessed with for, you know, decades. And mainly because of the tremendous discipline and time that is put into rendering images that exists simply to create the illusion of reality. And you might just say, well, I guess photorealist painters are out of a job. As in recent months, how pointedly it has been shown that these AI bots can create images within seconds that are so captivating. It brings to mind the word optimized. And so my take on this whole discussion really boils down to that word, optimized. At what point is artistic expression optimized through bots to the point where the artists, the human artists, are irrelevant? See, all these AI, whether it is a chatbot making text or an image bot making still images, they're all based on data sets gathered from the internet, billions of data points. And the data sets are built up on real work made by real human artists and real human writers. And then it's basically plagiarism on a mammoth scale. So these bots, they don't create anything from scratch. They're looking at the work of human artists, thousands, millions of human writers, painters, cartoonists, taking all of this human potential, all this human creativity, and boiling it down into something that looks new and presenting it in a way that is optimized to get human attention. So I'm keenly aware of this because whenever I upload a video to YouTube, that when you load that video up, YouTube algorithm searches the entire video and it picks frames that are specific to what it believes are optimal for what humans will want to see. So when I upload like an old film that I've transferred, it will pick a key frame from that film that it believes is the eye catcher, the golden thumbnail. And it's always a face, usually a face of a woman taken out of the context, and usually a face of a woman who is smiling very broadly. And so there are all these key indicators that the algorithm knows that people are likely to click on, and it's already boiling it down and saying, look, I've looked at this whole video. This is exactly what the audience wants to see. This is the frame. And so all of these bots are doing just the same thing. You're telling the image bot to generate an image based on some keywords. Make me an image of a robot floating on a boat in the middle of the ocean and it's holding the taco. And it will scoop through its data set and it will put together an image, not only with the content that you're asking for, but it will optimize the image in a way that will be eye-catching because it knows through sheer statistics what people want to look at. And it begs the question, when art is optimized, where a bot is going to create an image that's going to catch the eye of everyone, and if you're a human being trying to create something new and doing something cutting edge or doing something unique, it's going to fall short of that because anything unique, anything human is going to fall short of optimization. And we're heading into an era where everything visual and everything written is going to be reaching a point of optimization where humans are going to be competing against completely optimized images and completely optimized text for the same audience. That audience being people. So are the refined tastes of people going to put people out of business because computers have learned the nuance of how to make the secret sauce better than the human artistic chefs can make the secret sauce to send something that's going to win people over where the human artist is going to struggle and struggle and struggle to get any attention doing something truly unique because they can't compete with a bot that's selling people what they already know they want to see and hear and read. I don't have the answer. It's going to play out, but it's very concerning. I can't imagine that there's any writer or artist on the planet right now that isn't really thinking about this and wondering where they're going to be in 5 years. I guess it all boils down to how willing is the public to digest and consume these fake images, this fake text, and are people even going to ever know the difference? It's a big question to be answered in the near future. I do wonder. And as someone who makes YouTube videos, it's just a matter of time, of course, before the bots begin to create moving images. And when deepfakes get into 4K and we end up with AI versions of ourselves talking complete nonsense on YouTube, saying things that we didn't say, making content that we didn't create, and getting more views than we get while doing it. There's going to come a time when all humans will be out of work. It'll just be the bots, and all humans will be consumers. That's the ultimate end of it, you know. The bots will make everything, humans will consume. And we will no longer be in the creative process because we've given up all of our data to the internet and the cloud. And now computers have just taken it all over and are plagiarizing our past to generate our future for us. All right, there we go. Thanks for watching. Thanks to my human supporters on Patreon making all these human-generated videos possible. Thank you, thank you, thank you, all you humans on Patreon. Wouldn't be able to do any of this without you. Hopefully we'll be continuing to make content into the future and the the bots won't take over this channel too soon. Still got some content to make before we all lose our jobs. So, all right. Thanks. I'm Fran. I'll be back here doing something real soon.
At the bench again.